Macmillan Audio presents Troublemaker, written and read by Christine O'Donnell. This book is not about me, or should I say, it's not just about me. It's not a memoir, although I plan to share bits and pieces of my life story, which I hope will place my views and my political journey into context. After all, you can't know where someone's going or why they're headed in that direction until you know where they've been, right? It's not a campaign journal, although there will be insights and anecdotes from the 2010 midterm elections, specifically about my own race for U.S. Senate in the great first state of Delaware. As is the case with many upstart candidates, it was my first try for the office, but this time out, I won a state primary upsetting our current congressman and former governor while capturing the attention of some of our most prominent political leaders and took my place on the national political stage. Of course, I would have much preferred that place be a U.S. Senate seat. There's still no denying that my candidacy made an impact. In fact, a recent study published by the Pew Project for Excellence in Journalism reported that my campaign received more coverage than that of any other 2010 political figure, which I guess means we must have hit at least a couple of positive notes along the way. At the very least, those notes were surely loud. My goal here is to inspire others to join me in the resurgence of American values that is reshaping our political landscape, to take part in a growing middle-class movement, and to help them realize that meaningful political involvement is within reach, and we all have a responsibility to get started on the reaching. In case you're wondering, the title is from a tag given to me by Time magazine in a 2010 roundup called "The Party Crashers Behind the New Republican Revival." The article focused on four conservative candidates making serious headway in four key races around the country. Marco Rubio, the upstart, who's now the junior United States Senator from Florida. Rand Paul, the populist, who's now the junior United States Senator from Kentucky. Meg Whitman, the billionaire, the former CEO of eBay, who'd won the Republican nomination for governor of California before losing the general election to Jerry Brown. And yours truly, the troublemaker, a designation I take as a compliment for the way it signaled I wasn't afraid to speak my heart on the campaign trail. Okay, so now you know why this book is called Troublemaker, and you know what this book is not. So what is it then? Well, it's all of the above. Categorize it however you want. A political memoir slash campaign diary slash position paper slash rallying cry with an emphasis on the slash. I'll be dipping into all these different genres, writing about my family, my call to political action, and the trouble I've made along the way. In the end, hopefully, there will be a hard to pigeonhole book that might stand as a telling barometer of the values I hold dear, a snapshot of what it was like in the campaign trenches, and a template for others looking to push some of the same buttons, albeit in their own communities, in their own ways. You might wonder, why write a book at all, and why now? Well, first and foremost, I'm writing this book because I now have a platform. That's one of the silver linings of all the fanfare that surrounded my race. After participating in a high-profile election, you have an opportunity to reach out to people in a new way. Win or lose, folks seem to want to hear what you have to say. So here I am, saying it, as long as I've got your attention. Not because I'm so full of myself to think I've lived a book-worthy life, nor do I think that the nuts and bolts of my background are of interest to anyone outside my family, my close circle of friends, or my most ardent supporters. But because there are lessons to be gleaned and shared by looking over one's shoulder and revisiting the paths that have led to the present place. Second, I'm hoping to gain some perspective on my own experiences while at the same time gathering my thoughts and strengthening my resolve for what lies ahead. If there's one thing I've learned at my first tries at elected office, it's that fighting the good fight can be wearying, even demoralizing. So one of the impulses behind this book is the chance to set the record straight on a number of issues that surfaced during the campaign, and in doing so, to set them aside. And as long as I'm on it, here's another thing I've learned. The establishment elite will not always welcome you with open arms. In Delaware, as elsewhere, the establishment isn't defined by party or ideology. It's endemic, and it cuts across labels and affiliations. It's the same all over. The establishment is a mindset. Not every incumbent or established politician is part of the establishment. Not every successful person is establishment. The phrase, as a pejorative, applies to establishment-minded people. Those in power and those who want to be in power. Those who share an eagerness to compromise their supposed principles and a willingness to step on people in order to get ahead. You can even find such people in the Tea Party movement, sad to say. Establishment-minded people plague all levels of government, all arenas, those who've made it and those who are still trying to make it. Think back to where you were just after our last presidential election. Remember the despair, the frustration? Maybe you even experienced a palpable fear for the future of our country. The news out of Washington was troubling to someone like me, to someone like you, perhaps. I still shudder when I recall some of the first initiatives crossed off the to-do list of our newly elected leaders, the hardly established establishment, if you will. Forcing us to pay for abortions overseas, check. Ending the DC Opportunity Scholarship Program, the one sliver of hope for low-income families in our nation's capital, check. Drafting a so-called stimulus bill that would spend almost $1 trillion on a Keynesian fantasy while millions of Americans lost their jobs and watched their savings disappear, check. It didn't end there, did it? Next came Obamacare and the bailouts, one industry after another. With our forces in Iraq and Afghanistan, there was confusion everywhere, with a persistent chatter about withdrawal dates that seemed to belie our actions on the ground. Plans for closing Gitmo, trying terrorists in Manhattan, our looming Supreme Court vacancies. Do you remember it? I know I did. In the face of all this uncertainty, the message sent to those of us who didn't like what we saw was to curl up in a fetal position and stay there for the next 8 years, thank you very much. Oh, how things have changed. During those dark, dark days when common sense, patriotic Americans were looking for even the faintest silver lining behind the blackest clouds, they stumbled across something else, the Constitution. You see, a funny thing happened on the way to our assigned seats on the sidelines. Those of us who had toiled for years in the values movement found ourselves surrounded by like-minded Americans who had rediscovered the most fundamental value of all, liberty. Try as they might, the establishment elites will never have the last word on liberty. There's something in our national DNA that gets our backs up and leaves us shouting at our would-be masters, "You're not the boss of us!" It's been this way for centuries. Thomas Jefferson said essentially the same thing, perhaps a bit more eloquently. The issue today is the same as it's been throughout all history, whether man shall be allowed to govern himself or be ruled by a small elite. Make no mistake, there are more of us than there are of them. And the thing of it is, the ruling elite don't get us. They call us wacky. They call us wingnuts. We call us we the people. We the people don't always agree. We don't always share the same strategy memos, endorse the same candidates, or speak off the same talking points. But what we share is a love for liberty and a willingness to fight for it. We're loud, we're rowdy, and we're passionate. Yet underneath the ruckus, there's an echo that takes me back to those great C.S. Lewis Narnia books that I used to read as a kid, where a little girl asks about Aslan the lion, the fearsome beast who comes to represent God in Lewis's universe. She asks whether he is safe. Her friend answers, "Safe? Who said anything about safe? Course he isn't safe, but he's good." That's what I feel about what's happening in America today with this grassroots groundswell, this revolution of reason, this love affair with liberty. It isn't tame, but boy, oh boy, it sure is good. Will the ruling elite come after us when they feel threatened? Yes. Will they smear our backgrounds and distort our records? No doubt. Will they lie about us, harass our families, and try their darndest to intimidate us? Better believe it. There's nothing safe or sure about what we're trying to do. But is it worth it? Well, let me ask you, is freedom worth it? Is America worth it? Are those unalienable rights worth a little alienation from the Beltway in-crowd? Yes, 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 1,000 times yes. Some have accused us of just being an aging crowd of former Reagan supporters and homeschoolers. They're trying to marginalize us and put us in a box. They don't get it either. We're not trying to take back our country. We are our country. We've always been in charge. That's liberty. You don't have to assert your authority when everyone's on good behavior. It's when the wheels fall off that the grown-ups have to step in and step up. And I'd say we've been awfully patient so far. We've let the incremental assault on our freedoms, on our values, on our free enterprise, on property rights, and on our economic stability go on way too long. We've watched the tentacles of big government reach into every part of our lives. We've held our tongues as Washington bureaucrats and politicians told us what kind of light bulbs we can use, what kind of toilets we can flush, what kind of cars we can drive, what kind of food we can buy or sell. They want to tell small businesses what kind of jobs to create or what kind of commercials they can run. They even want unelected panels of administrators to decide who gets life-saving medical care and who is just too old or too expensive to be worth saving. They'll buy your teenage daughter an abortion, but they won't let her buy a sugary soda at a school vending machine. In Delaware, to note another powerful example, a teenager can't even use a tanning bed without a parent's permission, but that same teenager can get an abortion without parental consent. How could a tanning bed be more dangerous than risky surgery? Consider, every American child born today already owes over $200,000, his or her piece of the national debt and unfunded future liabilities. Folks, what kind of parent sticks the bill for today's spending to kids who will have to pay for it tomorrow? Did your mom and dad do that to you? Think about your parents or your grandparents and the sacrifices they made so you could have a chance at the American dream. Think what that dream has become. I'm one of 6 kids. There were a lot of meatballs to make and mouths to feed. My parents struggled to make ends meet. It was never easy. And as I grew older and set out on my own, it was still a struggle. I never had a cushy job or a company car. It took me over a decade to pay off my student loans. I never had to agonize over where to dock my yacht to reduce my taxes, and I'll bet most of you never had to either. Today, the richest, most recession-proof segment of society is the one made up of government workers. They average twice the salary and benefits of those in the private business sector. Their jobs, for the most part, are secure. In Washington, D.C., over the past couple years, the recession has hardly been felt at all. After all, it's a company town. Meanwhile, those of us on the outside looking in are told that we're not taxed enough. We're told that the dry cleaner down the street as a small business owner is somehow rich and that he may need to pay more taxes. This neighbor of ours has first to pay his rent and utilities, and the salaries and benefits of his 4 employees, Before he feeds, clothes, and shelters his own family with the moderate amount of money he takes in through his dry cleaning. We're told we're heartless and somehow unpatriotic if we let on that we're sick and tired of government budgets increasing every year while our own salaries are frozen or cut. This is not the America we've known. My generation grew up in a time of peace and prosperity, big dreams and bold risks. As the Berlin Wall came down on our TV screens, we saw the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.